IPS and use for reports itself. Stem cells since Yamanaka's work, and that has really expanded. Modified cells, progenitor cells, etc. The worry about that, there has been a lot of claims, counterclaims, and a certain degree of hype, as you can see in these two reviews, which my colleagues and myself tried to look at the trial. There was a massive rush of taking this technology to the clinic. Is it justified or not justified? We can argue about that. But if you review the evidence, like we tried to do, and we find fancy names like of these trials, like Caduceus, Scipio, Arcadia, cell therapy trials using, in this case, cardiac-derived progenitor cells. And the improvement was marginal and was not sustained. Equally, if you look at clinical trials of bone marrow-derived cells, we called it time to move on, because in these trials, you're trying to get rid of them. Thank you. In these clinical trials with bone marrow derived cells, like Pine, Swiss AM, Cellwave, Poseidon, CellCure, again, either with these cells in their native form or modified, the results were not as we wanted them to be. Now, there's a lot of excitement about the role of the extracellular matrix and how we that interacts with the cells, instructs the cells, and you have two-way information going between the cell and the ECM or the scaffold, and that is being pursued by many groups, including ours, in looking at either synthetic or biologic scaffolds which can instruct the cells. And you can decorate these scaffolds by a variety of molecules, like with hydrogel scaffolds, which can actually improve or recruit or instruct the cells to do the function you exactly want. And that is extremely exciting. In myocardial patches, the topology in itself, like has been shown by many people, and this is Chris Rao, who is a surgical resident who spent some time in the lab, which is still a channel in our group. And he's shown definitively that just topology actually instructs biology in a big way. Now, I talked about Yamanaka and his work in the indirect reprogramming, but now we have moved into direct programming, initially on mice and then in humans. And this is quite exciting, and I'm sure all of you will be familiar with Shinya Yamanaka, the work which really was quite a revolution when, with four transcription factors, he gets a skin fibroblast to become important cells, and then you can differentiate it quite easily into myocytes or neurological cells or whatever you want. But this has evolved with Deepak, who is a pediatric cardiologist, I think, and he's shown Deepak's work is really fascinating, that he used, again, different transcription factors to induce direct reprogramming without having to go through the story. That was in mice, But Eric Olson went on to show that you can do that in humans, but my dog with a lot more factors than the ones which were used in mice. But it's possible. So it is. Then humans, Hisham Sadeh showed very interesting work, and we're working with him in a Redouf Foundation grant, where he showed that you can induce myocardial cells into to divide and enter the cell cycle, and that can happen both in the zebrafish and embryonic mice. But importantly to us, with the use of left ventricular assist devices, and that is really very exciting, and we are pursuing that. And they call it in that editorial, is it a paradigm shift? Gene therapy has been under a cloud for a long time because of the induction of cancer and the lack of good vectors and also the lack of battle of the appropriate molecules. But it is, as this news and views in Nature recently, with saying it is returning to center stage, moving slowly to center stage because of the having new vectors and new molecules. But what is most intriguing is gene editing, particularly using CRISPR-Cas9, where you can really insert any gene anywhere without vectors, and that is the future. But it has again to be used widely and without too much hype and using the glory and getting rid of the threat. And this is the concept of the CRISPR-Cas9, which you will be familiar with. So transplantation has moved to regeneration, but transplantation is still with us, instructing us, looking for specific immune tolerance. And progress is accelerating, and that's very exciting. That brings me to the second part of my talk, and I hope to be quick. And that is that we're generating all this knowledge. What's it for? It is to benefit humanity. Where is humanity? Is it only in the developed world? Is it only the lucky 15 to 20% of the world population who happen to be in the developed world? This is really bad. Because over 80% of people are totally neglected and are not benefiting from the knowledge which is being generated. And this is that. Where is the glory? The threat of both science and medicine. And just this is the size of the problem. As one of my colleagues said, who cares? But who acts? Who pays? These questions need to be answered, but it's not impossible. Who are the stakeholders? And I'll show you there are many examples. Paul W. White said that all patients are the same, but are they? This Nicosi Johnson, a little boy born with HIV, contracted during birth, knew he was going to die at the age of 10 or 12, went on saying, never mind, I'm going to make my life matter. And kept saying, we are all the same, and we should be treated the same. That book published by Jim Wotton was really a hit because it summarizes the problems very, very well. We are all the same, but we're not. And you can see that very clearly in life expectancy, which can be as low as 28 years in Malawi, or 88 years in developed So in saying who cares, we can say, or every human being has to care. Who acts? We as cardiac professionals really have to act, and for several reasons. One, that we see the suffering firsthand. We do. We have access to international networks like here. We can act in small groups, have initial quick wins, which can add up to big wins. We can have a sustained effort and we can show the way. Who pays really doesn't matter, because we can have small consortia with not too much money, many, many small donors like we have witnessed in Aswan. The poor people are showering the center with $5, $2, and it adds up to millions. So who pays is not the biggest issue. And having a group who believe in the same thing, working together, and we should have the support of the governments, but do not ever rely on governmental support for more than one reason. The first is that they don't have enough money to cope with all what they have to do. Two, they are interested in being re-elected and not in the people. And that's everywhere. And three, that if there is a degree of corruption and I don't know what, and they do not believe in the same values which the professional think about. And it's all to do about with values and excellence and all that. Governments will not give you that. And finally, they will interfere with everything you do. And if you want to move fast towards the target, you must have autonomy to move fast. So the advice is, you should have government support, yes. Fight. But we don't get any money from your government. Thank you very much. They love that. And we love it. And I have the models, and that has been summarized in several articles, like taking cardiac surgery to the people, published in the Journal of Translational Research, and in Circulation and so on. It's very, very important that these efforts should be guarantee sustainability. So they should not just be for the period of our life, because our life is quite short. And I could disappear, any of us could disappear. But this effort has to continue. And there are ways of making it sustainable, both in terms of human resources, but also material resources. And human resources are much more important than material resources. If you need young people who believe in the same cause, who's carrying the can long after you have disappeared. How do you do that? By creating humanitarian. By that I mean it should be accessible to everybody, not to the privileged few. This is important. They should have excellence built into them. It should be free of charge. It should have the high standard. It should have a lot of training. And importantly, integrate research for clinical translation and basic science from the very beginning. It's not free. So in Aswan, for example, 20% of the resources are spent on research. It's not a luxury. You've heard about the Chain of Hope, which is a charity in the UK, which is in 9 countries in Africa and the Caribbean. I took quickly about one of them, which is the most developed right now, and it's Aswan Heart Center. This is Aswan. Very beautiful. Good, really. And but also has a lot of history, a lot of culture. 70% of the antiquities of the world are within a radius of 100 miles. Really not that. But equally, it's very poor and it's very neglected. And therefore, it deserves a center of excellence. And this is the Aswan Center, which was initially taking part of the existing hospital and then building, a purpose-built intensive care for children. And this is one of them. It has grown and grown. And cardiac surgery has increased, and now it is up to about 800 a year. 60% of children, a lot of neonates, particularly neonatal switches, which can be 2 to 3 in a day, done by the local surgeons. And the cost is coming down, and this is the research center, which is inside the hospital, and has molecular, cellular, and biomedical engineers. And this is the staff, which have grown in 5 years of the Aswan Heart Center. There are other centers in Africa, and one of them is in Mozambique, and it does research, population research in where the people live, and it is in collaboration with the established the Maputo Heart Institute, and a smaller offshoots in the endemic area of Inharim. And interestingly, the chiefs themselves were helping with carrying the research equipment, because they said this is benefit to our community. And health and knowledge, they said it, not me, are the most important attributes. These are the chiefs. It's interesting that Anna Olga Mukombi, who probably is known to many of you, actually did her PhD at Imperial College with distinction. She's back there with the chiefs doing field research and in endomyocardial fibrosis, which can be treated surgically very effectively. There are centers in Ethiopia, there's Kampala, and there is evolving in Burundi, although we have many problems because of politics. If we go back to the Aswan Heart Center, you find that rheumatic heart disease and surgery for rheumatic heart disease is a huge problem still and constitutes up to 25% of the operations done there. So we're doing new or developing what is already known in terms of using repair by actually peeling the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve. You can see that by peeling the anterior leaflet, you can increase length dramatically, and with length also coarctation. Because this is very important, because the problems of using prosthetic valves in the developing world is massive. They're just dying. You say, I'm doing a heart operation, you send them home, and 30% are dead within 5 years. And it's just not good enough. In transposition of the great arteries, I have told you what's happening in Aswan, where with the arterial switch operation, they've done 500. In the last 5 years, and is going up. And with excellent results, we still have infection as a major problem, because the mortality of the operation is like 2 to 3% in the first week. But if you add up by 8 weeks, it is up to 15% because of the infection. We have a lot of patients with neglected transposition, and you'll be glad to hear that we have resurrected the muscle operation, but we also modified it because these patients have pulmonary hypertension, whether they have a ventricular septal defect or not, they have pulmonary hypertension. And we try and improve the filling of the left ventricle by, we modify the muscle operation to include part of the left atrium and the right atrium with the conduit through the left ventricle. And you see that the filling of the left ventricle is so much better. And they cope with pulmonary hypertension beautifully. They've done like 55, 60 operations without mortality. And with very encouraging results in resurrecting the mustard operation, which originated here in this center. So, the last few slides, two or three slides, with the dream of the new Aswan. Now with the massive demand, we have enlisted the help of Norman Foster, Lord Foster, who is one of the greatest architects worldwide, in having this campus on the west side of the Nile. And the campus has a boulevard in the middle, which that is, and it has taken the shape of the felucca to form something like the Sydney Opera House. And the hospital is on the Nile in three floors, one for clinical, one for research, and one for meeting, with a campus in quadrangles reminiscent of Cambridge and Oxford. And that is, the patient rooms are, each one of them sees the Nile, and there are separate rooms, as you can see. And on the top, you'll have this shape of the felucca, which looks like Sydney Opera House, but as Lord Foster says, they are used for conserving energy, and the entire energy for the hospital and the community around it is supplied by renewable energy, solar energy, no pollution anymore. So in conclusion, science and medicine offers unprecedented opportunity for discovery and alleviating human suffering, but there are major threats which have to be watched. If